went to Moscow just after the fall of the Berlin Wall and animated Shakespeare, as one does. And this lovely guy, he survived the coup against Gorbachev and against Yeltsin. And with the coup against Yeltsin, the studio where they were making it came under mortar fire, and I was watching it on CNN. And there, when I went to visit about 2 weeks later, there was still glass in the studio, the holes in the studio, and as I say, he somehow survived on that. And he's quite a favourite. That is Malvolio. So your school might do Romeo and Juliet, yours Othello, yours Julius Caesar, yours Midsummer Night's Dream. Those four schools appear in a professional theatre for the first time together as a community and put on four different plays. We started in Pembrokeshire with just 8 schools over 2 nights and 200 pupils. Now, 17 years later, we're in 1,200 schools and 30,000 young people from the ages of years 5 to 12, and they perform in 150 theatres across the UK.
I actually played Hermione and gave the voice to Hermione in that production, that half-hour production. And I sort of wish I had Shakespeare's text in front of me today, because I'm so much more comfortable speaking other words than being myself. But I'm so pleased to have the opportunity to be here and to be introducing you to the Shakespeare Schools Festival, which is such an important organization. Shakespeare is with us today because his plays are full of imagination, and they're about communicating ideas and emotions. And we give that opportunity to children across the country, as you've seen. And you've seen how excited they are by doing that. They are able to use the language, use those stories, and work, what is so important, in front of an audience. This is not about just doing something in school and about learning about Shakespeare. This is actually about learning about oneself, learning about the way one feels, and reaching out into the community. And the schools that you hopefully will be supporting and helping to register and take part will benefit so much from that experience. You've heard some of them discuss some of that, and you're about to see an extraordinary school. I think one of the things that is amazing about this is that the children find out how clever they are when they start to explore the language, the text, the stories, and they feel that they can actually get that across. And we have a big theatre tonight, and we have a group, a very special group from Winchester, a special school, the Osborne School, who took part in Shakespeare School Festival last year, and they did a production, a half-hour production, of Midsummer Night's Dream. And tonight they're going to demonstrate a part of that. So I'm going to welcome them onto the stage now.
You've got the teenage wedding and the old folks wish them well. You can see that Pierre did truly love the matter of her. And now the young monsieur and madame live from the chapel. Found work.
Partnership with Rotary that we started a year or so ago now, because Shakespeare Schools Festival contacts the schools and tells the schools that if they need help to contact Rotary, to contact their local Rotary club. So it's that way around. It isn't asking which of our cricket teams he selected, but I hope it's one of the successful ones. And anyway, I'm not allowed to mention cricket this week with our president and what happened recently. But as I just did, and he's smiling, I'm okay. And he's also now a raconteur of Sunderland. So please, ladies and gentlemen, give a welcome to Jeff Miller.
My world has been cricket. It's been cricket for over 40 years. Cricket is a game of statistics. You are measured by the facts and the figures that appear in a scorebook at the end of the career. To let you know what you have with you this afternoon, I'd like to relate those to you. Scored over 18,000 runs. I took over 1,000 wickets. I held over 400 catches. I dropped 627. And in my defence, two of those were difficult. I was an all-rounder. I started with a naught against Lancashire in 1917. I didn't bowl. I finished with naught for 125 against Yorkshire at Scarborough in 1919. I didn't bat. I was the most boring player that ever stood on a cricket field and picked the England side for 14 years. So if you want to know what a strange game of cricket it is, you have invited the most interesting person this afternoon. The game has changed. Ladies and gentlemen, how the game has changed. The England changing room now, as well as the players, they have a biomechanic. They have a mental strategist. They have a psychoanalyst. They have a dietitian, a physician, a masseur, a strength and conditioning coach, and a lifestyle analyst. Now, when I played the game, one fella did all that lot. And he was a semi-skilled chiropodist from Belper. That's how the game's changed. Where did it all start, from a personal point of view? It started, and listening to Jenny, these school children. Mine was Chesterfield Grammar School. 10 O-levels. Taken. I played for the England Schools Cricket Association against the West Indies here in this country. And took my O-levels, didn't do very well. The headmaster, Geoffrey Price, said, "You must leave school immediately. Your academics are not up to standard." "Sir, I want to play cricket as a career." "You don't play sport as a career. You've got to leave school." That was on a Monday. On the Friday, he called me into his office. He sat there over in the desk with a mortarboard and the cloak. And I put a piece of paper down on his table. I picked it up and read it. And he said, "What are we going to do about this boy?" And I'd been selected for the England Schools Cricket Tour of India the following winter, proviso was that I was still at school. And he looked at me and said, "You will leave school immediately you get back from India." So I went to India, ladies and gentlemen. I did all right. I thought it won't matter because Derbyshire will take me on the staff and my cricket career will be off and running. I got back from India. Derbyshire didn't take me on the staff. I went back to Chesterfield Grammar School. I'm walking along a corridor. The headmaster's walking the other way, mortarboard and cloak. "What are you doing here, boy?" I said, "I've just got back, sir. I've been in India for 2 months. I'm as brown as a berry." He said, "We agree that you left school immediately. You shouldn't be here." I said, "Sir, can I say cheerio to my friends?" He said, "Well, don't be here at the weekend." On the Friday, he called me into his office after assembly, put a piece of paper down. I picked it up and read it. Been selected as vice captain of the England Schools Cricket Tour of the West Indies the following winter. Proviso was that. He said, "We'll create a new form for you." I was in lower six extra. It was only me in it. He said, "Keep out of my way. Don't bring the school into disrepute. And when you get back from the West Indies, you'll leave school immediately." He said, "No, I want you to take an A-level." I said, "Well, I like art, sir." He said, "Well, go and see Mr. Searcy, and he'll teach you how to write." So I went to see Mr. Searcy. I did my art A-level. For two terms, I spent 38 periods in the gym and two in the art room. I went to the West Indies. I came back. Derbyshire took me on the staff. My career started. 3 years later, I played for England. I got back after the test match, which I'll tell you about in a second or two, and waiting for me at 2 Enfield Road, semi-detached, Ivory Estate, Chesterfield, 2 up, 2 down, was a letter from Chesterfield Grammar School from Geoffrey Price, the headmaster, saying how I'd brought credit to the school.
And that is Alan McLaughlin.
And Good afternoon, Bob Flint. Pick up, click up. That wasn't me, I promise you. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll be aware from the conference in Belfast last year that we've been fortunate enough to secure the services of Eric Knowles to be our Rotary Foundation champion. Now, Eric was chosen because A, he was cheap and available, and B, because he's a thoroughly nice bloke and a friend of one of our committee members. Eric was chosen, coincidentally, because it coincides with our new mantra, every Rotarian's individual charity. Every one of you is a stakeholder in Rotary Foundation PLC. You don't have to sign up for it, you got the job when you joined Rotary. Rotary and Foundation are synonymous. There is no question of you opting in or opting out. So on that basis, we've decided to revise the way we're trying to present it, and Eric has very kindly agreed to become our patron. He's going to present a couple of awards for us to two clubs who have been showing the most initiative and creativity and raising funds and raising our profile throughout the course of this year. So you paid a lot of money, as Jeff was talking about earlier, and you want to see the star of the show. So ladies and gentlemen, could you please give a welcome to Eric Knowles. Thank you.
Before I actually start, I've got a message actually here from my local, I say local, my old neck of the woods, Nelson. When they heard I was going to be here today, they sent me this message, and I said I would go along and give it. It's only because that they've got their member, Edward Grimshaw, who can't be here today because he's 111, which is remarkable. And I do say, yeah, give him a round of applause. I did say I would take a photograph. So would you give me a big wave for Edward? Give me, no, that bit, that's it, lovely, wait for it. Lovely, and over here, that's where the money is. Okay. Big wave, got my specs on. Edward Grimshaw can't be here today because he's ill. Hey, listen, you know you've made it in life when Jeff Miller and Jenny Agutter are the warm-up acts. I mean, what more can you say? You're showing me age. But either way, the secondary award goes to Rotarian Andy Dunlop. Now, he's been nominated by the Sleaford Club in District 1070. Andy is described as this. He is a 50-something retired firefighter, now a country gentleman, a communist activist, a community activist. Described by his club president as being a total head case, who is mad as a box of frogs. So he's in good company here. And a total all-round good egg. Now, let me explain that Andy has been nominated because of his unique achievement of creating the World Egg Throwing Federation, which has raised funds to send Rotarians to National Immunisation Days, or if you want a little bit of BBC abbreviation, NIDS. Because when I'm doing an OB, I have to do a TBC, and normally I've got to do it as a two-shot. He's also undertaken, a disaster relief work in the Philippine Islands and supported shelter box. And these funds go to Air Ambulance, Leukemia Research, British Heart Foundation, hospice work, multiple sclerosis, the Red Cross Sailability. They've all benefited from throwing eggs. Ladies and gentlemen, I think that is there a challenge?
There is. The fifth discipline is a game called Russian Egg Roulette. Now, in that, you've got six eggs. Five are cooked and hard-boiled and one's raw. And you've got to use your skill and judgment to select or to avoid the raw egg. And to prove that it's not the raw egg, you smash it on your own forehead.
Okay. Well, that sounds fantastic.
It's a shame we couldn't get Jenny to wear it first. Okay, sorry. I'm told you've got to face that way, and you've just got to concentrate just for 5 seconds. Just meditate on egg. Just thinking egg. All right, keep thinking egg. Okay, so what we've got here is six eggs, randomly moved around. Now, the way you do this is, because they all look the same, is that you use something called Reiki to feel for the life force that's within the egg. Now, you place your hand over the top and just reach across until you can identify which egg has got a life force. And then avoid it. And then the first egg you touch, you've got to use. You pick the egg up. As you know, every living creature's got an aura. All right, can you see it? Okay, I'll there's my head. Which one's it going to go for?
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Andy Dunlop. Round of applause.